Today I want to speak on the theme God of the Turnaround, based on the events recorded in the book of Esther. But before I do, I want to give you some up-to-date context of the terrible plan of Haman in 474 BC to destroy every single Jew who was then living in what today we know as Iran. Esther chapter 3 verse 6 says that having learned who Mordecai's people were, he scorned, that is Haman, scorned the idea of killing only Mordecai. Instead, Haman looked for a way to destroy all Mordecai's people, the Jews, throughout the whole kingdom of Xerxes. Today, Iran is actively planning to, quote, wipe Israel from the map and threatens a genocide against the Jews. Some other countries and radical Islamic groups share those vicious sentiments and evil goals. Many Jews now fear for their life in different parts of Western Europe. They face great hostility, even in the UK, on university campuses, on the internet, and in different areas of private and public life, and in national and international institutions like the United Nations. In the words of the title of a book by the British MP, John Mann, anti-Semitism is the oldest hatred. All this should be a great concern to every Christian, for not only are we called to love people of all races and religions, but as Christian believers, we should recognize that we owe a particular and enormous spiritual and moral debt to the Jewish people. Our Christian roots are Jewish roots, and our faith is, of course, focused on the unique Jewish rabbi from Nazareth, who we Christians believe is the promised Messiah that the Hebrew prophet spoke of. And the Bible tells us that we should honor and love the Jews for different reasons, because it was through them that the Ten Commandments were given. We received knowledge of the unchanging covenants of God, the revelation of God's character, and many other blessings. Therefore, it matters, it really matters, that as Christians, we do all we can to pray for and to stand by the Jewish people, both in our words and our actions, as many have done before. Not so many sometimes, but people like the pastors Bonhoeffer, Niemöller, Corrie ten Boom, and Queen Esther that we are hearing about today. But as we make our stand against this and other forms of evil, and as we face the problems and pressures of the pandemic and many other difficulties that you may personally be feeling, we should all also draw great hope from this story of dramatic turnaround. So let's move on to my text today. In some ways, it's a bit of a gruesome text, but it's also a very inspiring text. Esther then, chapter 7 and verse 10, it says, "So they hanged Haman on the gallows he had prepared for Mordecai." What a text in the scripture. In just a few words, we discover that one of the most evil men in history ended up receiving the punishment, the very same punishment that he had intended his worst enemy to have. Now, the God of the Bible is a God of remarkable turnaround. He can and does and will turn around individual lives, families, churches, even nations, no matter how bad things could be. And we have heard today in some of the readings, particularly that reading with the four musketeers, how there was a great transformation when the king in Nineveh and all the people of Nineveh repented. And they really were serious before God in their repentance, and God saw it and he turned around, and the judgment that was planned didn't come. What a turnaround that was. All through the Bible, we see how God can turn all kinds of situations around. Psalm 66. Verse 6 says this, "He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the waters on foot. Come, let us rejoice in the Lord." Isaiah 41 verse 18 says, "I will make rivers to flow on barren heights and springs within the valleys. I will turn the desert into pools of water and the parched ground into springs. Jeremiah 31:13 says, I will turn their mourning into gladness. Now, I've experienced this in my own life, and you can experience it in yours. It said, I will give them comfort and joy instead of sorrow. In Malachi, the end of the Old Testament, says this, chapter 4, verse 6, he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. That needs to happen many times naturally, but also with spiritual fathers and sons and daughters. Now, in this book of Esther, we can see some key lessons. First of all, let's look at this. God can turn the toughest situation around. The wicked, or as Esther described them, the wicked and vile Haman, was in high position in the vast Persian Empire. He was a descendant of King Ahab, who Israel's first king, Saul, refused to put to death. His hatred of the Jews was not just general, but it was also very personal. He could not stand Mordecai, who refused to be intimidated by Haman. And this enraged Haman, who clearly measured his influence by the number of people who feared him. So because of all his hatred and his plotting, the whole of the Jewish people, every single Jew, faced imminent annihilation, Mordecai sooner than the rest. So Haman had this gallows built 75 foot high. He wanted him to be high and everybody to see what had happened here. And Haman was determined that Mordecai would have just one more night on earth. There seemed no way out for Mordecai or for the Jewish people. Really, it seemed an impossible situation. And many people today find themselves in situations, sadly, where they think, oh, there's no way out of this. Maybe you are one of them. You cannot see a way out or forward in your marriage. You cannot see how you can bring your children up on your own. You cannot see how you can get out of debt, which seems to be piling up all the time. Maybe you've had bad medical news from the doctor and you can't see a way out of the physical condition that you're in. Maybe you can't see a way out for your kids or your grandkids of particular situations that they may face. Can't see a way out for your family who, I don't know, there are things in your family you say, I just can't see a way forward here. I can't see how good can ever come from where we are. And when we look, sometimes at whole countries, you say things are getting worse and worse, and you look at the world, what is the way out? What's the way out of this pandemic? You can't see a way out. Well, Mordecai and the Jews found themselves in the most desperate of circumstances. And yet it all turned around, which leads to my next point, which you really need to hear. Number two, God will turn around things in his own timing and in his own way. Things were out of Mordecai's control, but they were not out of God's control, as events were about to prove. God's timing was to prove perfect. Now, sometimes before, Mordecai had uncovered a plot to assassinate the king, and it was all officially recorded, but somehow it was all forgotten. But now, on the very night which was supposed to be the last night on earth for Mordecai, this very night, the king is not able to sleep and didn't have TV in those days. So for entertainment, he got to read some of the official records. And he read, or had read to him, about Mordecai. On that very night, Mordecai was brought to the king's attention. How about that for timing? Esther chapter 6 verse 1 says, that night, the king could not sleep. So he ordered the book of the Chronicles, the record of his reign, to be brought in and read to him. The king had a big question. Well, what do we do for this guy? What honor, it says in Esther 6 verse 3. What honor and recognition has Mordecai received for this? Nothing has been done for him, his attendants answered. From this moment, at this very moment, this pivotal moment, things would suddenly and totally changed for Mordecai and indeed the Jewish people, just as they changed suddenly for Joseph. Many years, Joseph seemed to be just rotting away, best years of his life in an Egyptian prison, but God has a plan to quickly elevate him and he's suddenly the prime minister. So often, God allows us to go through circumstances, maybe you're going through them and they seem endless. What's a way out of that? But there is a way out coming in the right time. Don't take things into your own hand. Trust in God's perfect timing. And you say, well, he's certainly taken me to the brink. Well, the main thing is you've not gone over. And at the right moment, God will give you his answer. Suddenly, the Lord will come to his temple. Suddenly. It's so important to learn to trust the timing of God. Habakkuk 2:3 puts it like this. Though the vision wait or linger, we used to say tarry. Though the vision linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and not delay. Be patient to receive the perfect timing of God. But also, we need to learn here that God's ways are perfect. God has a plan to bring good to our lives. And it's not so often the way that we would bring that plan to our life. At the very moment, the king was wondering how to honor Mordecai, who should come in to the court, who should be around at that very moment is indeed Haman. Haman had actually come in at that moment to ask for permission to get the whole process finished, finalized of hanging Mordecai at that very moment. But before Haman could speak, the king wanted to know from him what his ideas were for the best way to honor somebody that he really favored. Well, Haman, full of himself, thought, well, I mean, come on, who else is more likely to get an honor? So he laid it on the thick what the person should receive. We read in Esther 7:7-10, for the man the king delights to honor, have them bring a royal robe the king has worn and a horse the king has ridden, one with a royal crest placed on its head. Then let the robe and the horse be entrusted to one of the king's most noble princes. Let them robe the man the king delights to honor and lead him on the horse through the city streets, proclaiming before him, this is what is done for the man the king delights to honor. And we can imagine Haman standing there waiting for the king to say, well, actually, Haman, great advice, but this is all for you. But instead, the king said something very different. And he said, good idea, basically. Go and do all this for Mordecai. And so we read that Haman got the robe and the horse. He rode Mordecai and led him on the horseback through the city streets, proclaiming before him, this is what is done for the man the king delights to honor. The very person who was so against Mordecai was the one who had to honor him in a way that Haman himself wanted to be honored. Well, who could have written a script like this? It all seems too far-fetched and very ironic. But God has amazing ways to bring down the proud and to elevate the humble in the right moment. For sure, God's ways are not our ways, but they are certainly higher and they keep getting better. They're much better than our plans, than all that we could imagine. So we see in our final point here that God will turn things around totally. God can decisively deliver you from all your enemies and the situation that you're in. You can have a total change around. What Haman didn't know was that Mordecai had looked after his orphaned cousin and brought her up, been very kind to her, trained her up in the Jewish ways here. Her name was Hadassah, but now she wasn't known as Hadassah, for she was Queen Esther. And it was now in this moment that Queen Esther chose to expose Haman and all the wicked plans he had to kill all the Jews. Haman was terrified when he saw what was unfolding before him, and he pleaded for his life. Unfortunately, we read for him in Esther chapter 7, verse 8, that he was falling onto the couch. Esther was reclining A king came in and he saw this. Will he even molest the queen while she's with me in the house? As soon as the word left the king's mouth, they covered Haman's face. In other words, that's finished. He's out. At the king's command, we read in verse 10 that they hanged Haman on the gallows he had prepared for Mordecai, and then the king's fury subsided. God has a proven track record of taking what was meant for evil against us and turning it for our good. Do you remember that's what Joseph said to his brothers, and they were all so nervous about it and all the things he'd been through. He said, don't worry, God had a bigger plan here. And however much difficulty you may be in right now, you should be confident that God has the power to deliver you and your family and to bring you out into the best place in the right moment. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. You think, well, I'm in a war, and this war, when's it going to end? The pandemic, when is it going to end? When's my depression going to end? Where's there a way out? There is a way out in God's time and in God's ways. You can see total turnaround. We used to sing a song. It's amazing how I can remember things from, well, I won't say how many decades back, but more than one or two. And we used to sing this song quite often. Got any rivers you think are uncrossable? Got any mountains you can't tunnel through? God specializes in things thought impossible. He can do just what no other can do. Do I hear a hallelujah out there? Do you have an amen in your spirit? Do you believe that? Well, I believe it. And in this total turnaround that is recorded here, we see there are other blessings coming, that God also gave them new freedom. Due to Esther pleading for her people, we read in chapter 8 that the king gave Esther all Haman's estate, all his stuff, every property, everything. The orders for the planned Holocaust were all rescinded, and the Jews were granted the right to protect themselves and to prosper. So often, it is after your toughest battles that you come into your greatest blessings. That there is like a spiritual power to try and stop you, because there is greater blessing ahead. So stop you now before you get into it. But if you will pursue, if you will just stay calm, if you will trust God, if you just keep doing, as I heard recently by Lawrence Kong from Singapore, just do the next right thing. You will see that there comes a moment when God opens up whole new blessings for you, whole new opportunities, spacious places. And I believe this is going to be true for King's Church International in the UK, in Windsor, in London, and in South Africa. And for the global church, that when this lockdown is over, we are going to see God break things open, and many of the things that we have learnt and experienced in this time, we're going to say this was a preparation for what was to come. Be sure, God wants to bring you into a new place of freedom, spiritually, emotionally, physically, financially, relationally, that you can enjoy the goodness of God, because God is a God who sets us free. It's for freedom that Christ set us free. And the last thing is this, as part of this turnaround, is that God brings great joy to his people. Mordecai received amazing personal honor. You know, to the faithful, God will always show himself faithful. He became the second in command to the king. And the Jews, wow, they had quite a celebration. It says in Esther chapter 8, 16 to 17, for the Jews it was a time of happiness and joy, gladness and honor. In every province and in every city where the edict of the king went, there was joy and gladness amongst the Jews with feasting and celebration. Wow, total disaster is what they were facing, and they came into total deliverance. Instead of their destruction that God had brought them out, instead of extermination, now there's great exhilaration. Instead of death, there was life. No wonder the Jews had such a party, and it's why all these years on, they still party in remembrance of this amazing turnaround. So today, whatever situation you are in, God can work for you. When you commit your life to the Lord, he sees to it that all things will work together for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. He will work for your good both in this life and for the life to come. God loves you. God is for you. God can do more than you imagine. You feel under pressure now, but if only you could see the blessings he's got for you. What even in the time of pressure and difficulty, he's trying to work in you because he has a great destiny for you. Today, whether you are a Christian or a non-Christian, let me encourage you to not just trust in God, but to fully trust in God. Believe for change, even where you can't see how change is possible. And let God turn everything around. Let's pray together. Just bow your heads a moment. Let's take a moment for the Holy Spirit to just apply this word into our hearts. You know, Purim shows that even in the darkest hours, that God had not forgotten his people, the Jews. He still loves the Jewish people. Do you know he loves the Jews with an everlasting love? And we should share in that as well, to love the Jews. But God loves the whole world, not just one people. And he loves you. And the greatest evidence of his love is not seen at Purim or the events and that celebrates, but actually at Passover in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. For there, a way of deliverance was made, it was secured, greater even than the dramatic rescue from Haman's evil schemes. On a stark Roman cross, under the heading, the King of the Jews, the pure Lamb of God, the only Son of God, was sacrificed to save his ancient people and all mankind from sin and death and all the malignant forces of evil and hell. And when you receive Christ into your life and you keep him at the center of your life, anything bad can go and everything can change for good. Please pray with me if you would like today to say, I really need to get back with the Lord. I've lost my focus. I've looked at the problems. I've looked at the storms. I want to recommit my life to the Lord. Will you just pray with me? Lord Jesus, thank you for giving your life at the cross to rescue me from sin and all forms of destruction. Please forgive me for my sins and come into my life. I want to follow you and to joyfully receive your goodness and mercy. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer from your heart, you know, it's a simple prayer that God will hear, has heard, and this will be a turning point for your life. We don't have to pray fancy prayers, just God, I need you. What I prayed, I really mean. And so every day you can pray, every day you can talk to the Lord. Read his book, the Bible. It'll teach you more about the Lord. Get in contact with a group of Christians, a church that's going to build you in your faith and tell other people about him. By all means, contact us. We would love to help you in your journey of faith. Now let's pray together. I'd like to pray for everybody here. Heavenly Father, thank you that in this time of pandemic and so many different kinds of pressures, that we can be reminded again that you are the God who is over all, the God for whom all things are possible, that you are the God of the turnaround. Thank you, Lord, that your ways and your timings are perfect. Help us, Lord, to trust you every moment of every day in every situation. Please forgive us, Lord, when we go in our own strength or try to work things out in our own way. Help us, Lord, to really listen to you, to stay close to you, and to trust you, that you will bring everybody into a place of blessing. And right now, Lord, I pray for people who really have some sense of mourning, that you will take the mourning away and you will put a peace and you will put a joy in their heart. Those for whom things are not really flowing, Lord, that the new life of your Spirit would flow in their lives. I pray, Lord, that families would come closer together. I pray that every one of us would grow in our faith. Holy Spirit, we ask right now that you would come afresh to us, that we could know in a new way the blessing of God and the presence of God. Let your anointing rest on everybody. Let it be, Lord, like your touch. Just one touch from Jesus is all we need. That your touch is upon the lives of the boys and girls, that they can feel you are with them. The ones who may be older and on their own, that they know they're not alone. The parents and families, singles, people who may be struggling in some way, Lord, please let us take our heavy burdens off, stop carrying them and give them to you. And know, Lord, that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. We ask, Lord, day by day, that we will understand you are the God of the turnaround. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, and everybody said, amen. Well, God bless you. Thank you for listening to everything today. You know, you can connect with us. Go to the website.